Welcome everyone to For Your Consideration. My name is Sterling Hedgpeth. I'm the programming manager for both the DocLands Film Festival and the Mill Valley Film Festival. And Atlantis is the official submission for the Best International Film Academy Award from the Ukraine. And joining us today is the writer-director, who is Valentyn Vasyanovych, and the producer of the film, who is Vladimir Yatsenko, who will also be helping us with translation. So thank you so much for joining us. It really is a fantastic film. We appreciate you sharing it with us.
Thank you very much for inviting us. It's a big honor for us, and we are really glad to share our thoughts and our feelings with your audience.
Now, this is a very passionate film, but also one that is quite devastating because of, even though it's set ostensibly in the future, it really is about today. And so what was it about the film, the story of a certain veteran who's suffering from post-traumatic stress and the different coping mechanisms he has to try to deal with the everyday sadness of his life and of the country that he loves so much? What specifically created this story that you shared, and you and of course Valentyn shared with us?
Yeah, just one sec, I need time for translation, just one second. Он говорит, что такая прекрасная история, которая, несмотря на то, что она рассказывает про будущее, рассказывает про то, что происходит сейчас, и про человека, который пытается как-то существовать своим ежедневной грустью и печалью, страдая от посттравматического синдрома и с болью за свою страну, которую он видит разрушенной. Что тебя привело к созданию этого фильма?
Ну, привела ситуация, которая происходит в стране, действительно война. Я должен был отрефлексировать это событие, единственное, чтобы не фокусироваться на политическом как бы бэкграунде этой ситуации, которая была очень непонятна широкой аудитории, решил перепрыгнуть в будущее и подумать, как же эта война может закончиться для всех нас. Я, понятно, поскольку я оптимист, я верю в нашу победу, но эта победа будет достаточно грустная, как финал любой войны.
Okay. So, of course, this film is Valentyn's reflection of his own feelings regarding the war, which is actually happening right now already for 7 years on the east of Ukraine. And because we still have a war with Russia and Russian backup troops, which, of course, feeding the separatists on the east of our country. And actually, he tried to avoid all the current political things. So this is why he decided to jump in the future when the war is over, because he is optimist. And of course, he thinks that the war one day will over, but he also think about the price which we will pay for this victory in this war, because every wars have the same kind of ending, and we not even starting to pay in the price for it. So this is his reflection.
Ну, конечно же, я хотел показать ситуацию на уровне экологическом. И, в принципе, все действия, которые показаны в фильме, они уже происходят.
And what is very important, which maybe your audience don't know pretty well, this is like huge ecological catastrophe. It's, you can compare it with the Chernobyl, but it's not like happening immediately. It's something which is like continuing time, so it's slowly Chernobyl, let's put it this way. Why? Because it's huge ecological catastrophe which connected with the mines, this very rural region with a lot of mines which still collect the some of the metals beside of the coal. And most of these mines is very, very old. It's more than 100 years and more. And most of them closed already. But even when the mine is closed, they need to pump out this dirty water out and clean it. But on this territory, which we can't control, which controlled by separatist troops, the people just, cut all of this equipment for metal, sold it, and don't think about it. And even now we already feel it because this waters is starting to going up. And at some day, on some sad day in the nearest future, when this waters merge with water horizons, and this region have a huge deficit of water sources. So then it's gonna be huge catastrophic because it's still overpopulated area with 4.5 million people who live there. And of course, these people, when they face a situation where they don't have water to drink, they will go somewhere, which gonna be not only Russia or Ukraine, it's gonna be Europe. and some other countries. And it's going to be huge ecological catastrophe, which definitely will happen because we still not control this area. And scientists from the different countries, they are really, you know, ring the bells and say that, come on, guys, we should do something about it. And our task was also to bring the people attention to something which will happen pretty soon. And just try to say that it's something which we all only all together can solve.
And Sergei has a very powerful conversation with the woman who does that monitoring, because she, that's the reason why she's leaving. And we see at the factory that once they've actually done what they needed to do their damage, they just leave without any kind of responsibility. So those are some very powerful moments in the film itself. It's interesting because the film is a lot about, talks about memory, about digging up the past and trying to find some closure. But at the same time, it's also about the legacy of the war, about the long-term impact, which you just mentioned. And finding a really smart balance, a very touching balance about weighing the past and the future. Talk a little bit about how it was to build a screenplay so that those things could be infused into his own, Sergei's own personal life and personal observations.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Он говорит, ну, что это действительно очень крутой баланс между прошлым, который они раскапывают, недавним, и тем наследством, которое эта война оставила в будущее. Он спрашивает, как ты именно создавал эту историю, на чем ты базировался, когда создавал непосредственно? Ну, тут провокация, наверное.
Это именно по поводу информации.
По поводу вообще, как ты пришел к этой истории? Помнишь, что ты рассказал, что ты был в Мариуполе, ты смотрел много сюда?
Да, конечно, да, можно сказать, да, что я хорошо знаю, в общем-то, этот регион, меня всегда впечатлял своими огромными комбинатами, фантастической фактурой, я хотел там снять кино, и, в общем-то, события, военные события, в общем-то, привели меня туда, и относительно, можно упомянуть, что у нас все снимались как бы люди непрофессиональные актеры, все имеют опыт боевых действий, на настоящие саперы, на все настоящие патологоанатомы, и по поводу создания линии вот, вот группы, которая занимается эксгумациями, можно сказать, что вот нас консультировал Черный Тюльпан, он же снимался, он же этим сейчас занимается, он же работает по обе стороны территории.
So Valentyn says that when he created this story, he was totally blessed by this amazing locations. So for him, locations is very important piece of the any film. So he usually drive by what location can propose to him, like story wise, like frame wise, and so on. And he loves this region very much because it's have contain a huge factories. It's big. It's actually interesting evidence of presence of the people of the last century, like very, very rural region. And for him, it was very, very crucial to work with the real people. So all of the actors here is a non-professional. All of them, for example, our main hero, he's actually ex-soldier and now he's volunteer. So he's still coming on the front line and back. And this is somehow a little bit prevent him from the huge PTSD, which he definitely have in the real life. And the same with the woman character, because she is also working as paramedical on the front line. And they also work a lot with the real organization, which called Black Tulip, and which actually take care about exhumation of the dead bodies of soldiers from the both of the front line. So they're still working. I mean, it's 7 years of war, but they still work and still trying to find the soldiers and bring them peace. So for him, it was very, very crucial to be as much realistic, as much, you know, telling the truth as much as it possible in the feature film, of course.
The production design is quite extraordinary and very immersive. And I think something that really helps is that most of the shots are very long takes, they're very static. That forces us to observe lots of things. It's very observational. There's not a lot of editing, there's not a lot of manipulation. It's all just us drinking in everything. So we learn so much about Sergei, we learn so much about Katya because of the things that they do. They don't have to act as a character because they're being as much themselves as we can tell. And that makes it so much more moving. What was his strategy about using that style, the long takes, the static shots, very observational and very, it's not impersonal because we still learn a lot and we still learn a lot about them, but we see people living their lives, the mundane part of their lives and the horrific part of their lives.
Thank you very much. Just one second. Вот эти длинные кадры, как ты к этому пришел? Что ты в них видишь? Почему ты выбрал именно такую стратегию рассказа истории?
Ну, это мой не первый фильм, который я снимаю в этой стилистике. И мне,
то есть даже третий фильм, по факту.
Да, поскольку все-таки я как бы всегда отталкиваюсь от локации, от фактуры, от энергии, от энергии фонов, пейзажей, фактур. Для меня это важно, и когда я нахожу эту фактуру, мне остается просто насытить ее жизнью. Но сама эта фактура, эта локация мне подсказывает мизансцену всегда. И почему я делаю длинные шоты? Во-первых, я как бы наполняю, невидимо наполняю, в общем-то, как бы свою внутреннюю драматургию, ну, как бы мне они не скучно их смотреть. Вот с одной стороны, с другой стороны, я всегда даю промежуток времени, чтобы зритель принял эту сцену и начал думать и сопереживать, чтобы я его, в общем, тянул туда и дал ему время. То есть я не быстро заканчиваю, да, я даю время погрузиться, насладиться этой историей.
Okay. So this is this visual style which Valentyn used in this movie. It's actually a third movie which he use this style, because the first one was a very well-known film, The Tribe, also produced in Ukraine, which hit a lot of the International Film Festival and won one of the prizes in the Cannes. So Valentyn was the DOP and producer and also co-scriptwriter on this movie. And the next film which Valentyn used the same kind of technique, it was his own film, and he was a director of this film, which called Level of Blackness. And this is a short film, and he's, you know, still working in this approach, which give them the two things. The first one, because he is really always thrilled by location, and he follow the something which location can contain in terms of the how he would like to build the frame, which kind of composition he would like to use. And if we talk about the cut style, so this is very important for him to use the long shots, because he would like to fulfill it with internal dramaturgy leaving the people not to look on the attraction when you have film very cutty, but to fill each frame and to fill the life which contain each frame. So for him, it's very important when people just start and watch this long shots from the beginning, they're nervous, they think, okay, what's happened next? But then they start to just observing what's happened and feeling what's happened. And for him, this approach give the kind of help him synchronize the viewers with the actors in frame.
The effect is that you build more tension, because the more we watch, the more we worry about the characters and the more we wonder if something terrible will happen, because sometimes we just see a life, but sometimes the scene ends with something quite horrible. The infrared shots, the film opens and ends with these infrared shots, which also use that same quality, but the infrared visual is quite riveting and very unique in this kind of film. What inspired him to use the infrared?
Yeah, sure. Что тебя вдохновило на эти инфракрасные кадры и сказать ли ему вначале, почему в начале и в конце? Я думаю, в начале, потому что это отбирает жизнь, и мы видим, как эта жизнь утекает, а в конце, как, конечно, возможно, новая жизнь появится.
Конечно,
да?
Конечно.
А что тебя вдохновило?
Вдохновило меня, в общем-то, то, что мне в руки упала эта камера, и я увидел изображение, сделал какие-то съемки для себя, и я, в общем, собирался как раз снимать секс-сцену для этого фильма «Сцену любви», и изначально думал, что вот я хочу сделать секс-сцену в красном свете, меня вдохновляла эта вообще-то идея, но в итоге эта идея развалилась на две части. Я решил в начале фильма показать смерть, в конце любовь.
Класс. So basically for him it was quite accidentally he gets this infrared camera and he used it as a toy, just, you know, to shooting something around, and then he got the idea to shoot the sex scene with the dead bodies on this infrared camera. But then he realized that it's gonna be much precise if he can show in the beginning we see how the life is leaking and how death is coming, and you can see it. You can see it because the people just lose their warm and they became part of the earth, literally. And this is very impressive. And at the very end, he would like to show the love, which is actually the warm, and maybe the hope for the new life, which can be born soon. So this is very, very important, because this is why he start with this and end up with this, because it's a death, and this is new hope, and this is love. So this is why.
The sex scene ends up being profoundly moving, because it shows that Sergei has turned a corner in his willingness to embrace life in a way that for so long he was almost dead to it. And the film shows his hopelessness for the first half and before he meets Katya, and then she slowly, every single scene shows a little bit more hope. How rampant is post-traumatic stress occurring in the Ukraine with all its veterans and all its victims among the population, not just the soldiers, but the people?
Окей. Он говорит, что ну, невероятно, что герой вначале абсолютно потерян, пока он не встречает Катю, и постепенно, шаг за шагом, он как бы возвращается к жизни. Насколько в Украине сейчас распространен посттравматический синдром, по твоему мнению?
Ну, как он влияет? Это большая проблема, потому что институты, которые должны заниматься очень проблемой посттравматического синдрома, у нас отсутствуют. Вот, есть на каких-то волонтерских основах там что-то, ну, люди делают, но все равно это недостаточно, это капля в море, и это есть действительно большая проблема, как правило, на пятый год после там, скажем, получения этой травмы люди совершают непоправимое.
На пятый?
На пятый год. Mm-hmm. Да, у нас сейчас достаточно большое количество суицидов, и, к сожалению, это действительно большая проблема, mm-hmm. которая пока никак mm-hmm. не решается.
So like in any other war, of course, we have a lot of people who actually infected by this. But it's even worse in our particular situation, because in Ukraine, the government institution, which should take care of it, of course, they, like any other institutions, not really works. And it's a lot of people like you guys have after Vietnam, who is like really helpless. So they just, you know, they just broken and they just forgotten. And nobody really cares of it, and so it became just part of the problem for their families, for their friends, but government doesn't care about it at all. So it's no like new working places, nothing like that. And of course, I think we will have the influence of this for many, many, many years. We now have the huge increase of suicides for the people who came after the war, because they can't fit the normal life, and they can't see any rays of hope in the future. This is why they doing that. So for us, it's also it was very important to make this movie, also to address it to Ukrainian soldiers who struggling, you know, for some kind of really, really warm and help from our side, and sense that, you know, love can cure everything if you find this love. So it's really, really can cure everything. But of course, it's a huge social problem in our society, and I believe, alas, but we will have to deal with it for many, many years ahead.
You talked about they are in these static shots, they are wonderful compositions, and you talked about how most of the actors are non-professionals. Because there's so much going on in the background with all these small characters, what kind of direction does he give those characters? Just because they have to improvise, they have to act naturally, but they also have to act on camera for a long period of time. How does he work with those actors?
All right. Потому что у нас очень много есть на бэкграунде, довольно часто есть второплановых актеров, которые там существуют довольно длительное время. Как ты с ними работал, какие задачи ты им давал, просто чтобы они там жили, или они делали что-то очень точное, что ты им ставил? Находил ли ты людей, которые делают это, или это было не так важно?
Ну, если взять, например, как бы сцену с саперами, да, uh-huh. к примеру, да, сначала uh-huh. мы провели беседу, нам uh-huh. рассказали детально, как uh-huh. происходит процедура uh-huh. разминирования. На основе этого я предлагал свою мизансцену, мы еще раз ее обсуждали. Uh-huh. Если это как бы все выглядело правдоподобно, да, и мы брали за нее снимать несколько репетиций, и, в общем-то, люди, которые играют сами себя, солдаты, uh-huh. они совершенно делали uh-huh. это отлично. Если брать, скажем, сцену осмотра тела судмедэкспертом. Действительно был настоящий судмедэксперт. И когда мы попросили его как наговорить текст, чтобы мы могли его с ним работать, он сказал, дайте мне тело, я вам, в общем-то, проведу процедуру по полной. Он это сделал, это заняло минут 15, мы просто укоротили ее до 5 минут. В принципе, он делал настоящий осмотр. Лично ему он совершенно из дубля в дубль делал это великолепно, потому что это и есть часть его работы, из его работы.
So he gave a couple of examples, like for example, for the scene in the hospital when they have of, you know, exhumation body which they working on. So it was the real people who doing that every day. So for them it seems like very, very part of this job. So they wasn't they're just doing what they're doing usually. And the same for the, for example, scene with the sappers who is doing the bomb, how you call it, like bomb cleanings for area. So it's the same. He have the several interview with the real people, with real sappers, and they saying and tell him what they usually do, how they usually proceed. And then Valentyn try to build the mise-en-scene and work with them on this mise-en-scene. And when everybody says that, yes, it looks like the true one, so then he after several repetition makes the shots. So Valentyn have quite unique approach in the way, because as he is like a scriptwriter, director, DOP, editor and producer. So it's for him, it's the films which he is usually do, it's real author films in the way that he is control absolutely everything, every single aspect of the film. And because, and of course it's make the he usually shot the film twice, which is also quite unique, because he first of all shoot the film with real actors, with real wardrobe on the real location, but on the very with super small crew, like several people on the camera, because he has his own camera and so on. And then he make the like pre-editing of the film, and then he realized what is work, what is not work. And after he solve all of the problem of this pre-shooted films, so he calls a normal big crew and shoot everything very fast and very precise. So wow. This is huge creative freedom to improvise, to work with the, to try to fight the true voice of the every scene and to shoot it several twice if he needed, because it cost us peanuts. And when he's completely sure that he would love to get this particular shot, only then he's, you know, doing it with a big crew. And this of course give us the chance to tell the story, to try in the different ways of the tell of every scenes. And of course it gives a lot of creative freedom for him. So this is quite unique author method and which Valentyn uses in his movies.
That's all really amazing information to apply. It makes the fact that it turns out so well even greater, because of so much work that you both, as well as the entire team, goes into. I guess my last question is, what is Valentyn working on next? And Vladimir, what are you working on next as well?
Yeah, we are working on the next movie, which is called Reflection. And this movie, it's been selected for Berlinale co-production market on the beginning of last year. And now it's selected for Les Arcs co-production village. So we already have some conversation with some big international festivals and so on. And this is a film about the man who actually lose something important. It's a guy who worked as a surgeon in hospital. And then he actually went to the front line to help the soldiers, and he was captured. And then he was totally destroyed during this imprisoning. He was tortured and everything like that. And then, but it's everything happened in the first act. And then he go back home and he's totally destroyed. And he's trying to understand why he living for, what he have to do next. And then he found the body soul in his child, in his daughter. And then they together are getting much better each other, getting more deeply each other. And then he realized that it's some kind of life after your own personal catastrophe. So if we talk about the Atlantis as a destroying the country, the reflection is more about what what's happened with the people who destroy their own soul. And this is very important for us to discover. And so we are actually on the very finish on the shooting. So we plan to finalize everything this month. And then in the next month, we will have rough cut and so on. So we are really, really amazed to have the possibility to work so quickly on the next movie.
Well, that sounds fantastic. We hope to get a chance to see it. Thank you so much. Thank Good you. Luck on your project. Atlantis is a tragic film, but an incredibly touching and very powerful film. And again, on behalf of everyone here at the California Film Institute, we really appreciate the chance to see it. It's amazing.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting us. And have a great day. Thank you very much. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye.